Good evening and welcome to SVGTV News and Sports for Friday, December 27th, 2013. I am Jennifer Richardson with the details. A trough system which affected St. Vincent and the Grenadines and other Eastern Caribbean countries on Christmas Eve left behind hundreds of millions of dollars in damage in SVG alone. Many Vincentians are now trying to pick up the pieces of their lives. Some of the most affected are on the leeward side of the country. Jamisha Wright has this story.
And your baby is also unaccounted for.
Yeah.
How old is your baby?
She's gonna be 3 in March.
She is.
Shalani helped me.
They all were in, what happened? They were all in the home or something. What happened?
No, we were in the house and then the water started to come over and come in the house and rush down the house. And my mom called the police station to take out the house and they said to try and get out the house. And me and my uncle and my other 3 kids to try and get us and the baby and kids that want to go. My baby and I had my son and we had my other son and kids that were going, like we all was going together. And at one point the water like come down real heavy and the water came down heavy and he just fell us over and my uncle put up and we were going down like we're gonna die, like go down up like we're gonna start, right? Then after we managed to pull onto something and I feel somebody grab my foot. When I grab his hand was my son. Then my other son pulled onto my uncle. Then after I asked my uncle where Shalani, this girl Shalani get away. Then she jumped down and we managed to get over to a car and climb up on a wall or climb up on a chalk and climb up in a tree. And we stayed there until maybe half an hour, almost an hour.
You have an accent, you live here?
No.
You visited?
Yeah.
You just get for Christmas?
But I understand.
I was lying down on the bed and I get up and open the window. And then when I opened the window, I saw some water coming from underneath the house. So I wake up here and call him and say, country, come see. And then I go and wake up my last daughter. And she go back and she lie down. So after go back and wake up again, the water came up higher and higher. After my brother house come down and the house of the family and it brought down with each of us and I go under. I don't know where the other to go, but I know I go under and the house started to spin.
Where's your daughter? Where? Your daughter?
I don't know.
What's your name?
Conrad Jack.
And where are you from? You're from
Clement Bay.
Tell us what you experienced last night.
So last night about 11 o'clock, I did at my house. Well, you know, when you have man and man, you don't sleep naked. So we totally naked. So I told you, didn't know. A lady come and call. So I hear the voice call to time. So I opened the door. So I opened the door now. And I look outside, I see this big shot of water coming down. So I say, call Chantel, she come, let you go. Come out, so I tell you, put on a skirt. So after you put on a skirt, now it's water done reach inside the house, not full up the house. So after the day now, I can't come out in no way. Then at the CC house, I started moving and he was just busting at two. So we're busting it to now, we call up on the ears with the galvanizer and them and some peg wire. So after, I hold she on, and then she come down together. My water beating, so then she come down together. And when he reach my arm, he bridge there. A big she hold me and lock me wrong, and she get away from me. And I never see she again. And it's quite long here, they get me.
So brother P, the whole thing's going.
Well, we thank God to be alive because Tuesday night, when it's back all here, there was a back all here.
Yes.
And after the back all broken down, the water was flushed straight down.
Where your Jeep was back?
My Jeep was back in the alley, and the water pushed it back to the golden apple tree, and just jam it. That green jeep, this bag in the yard, and we had to push it back to Mr. Galley, the refugee. Mm-hmm. After the back wall broke down. Water is joke. This building, you see the water just flying over, flying over. Gas balloons just flying down in the water and just it down the road. Funny, they call me funny.
Sunny, are you saying that this structure over there, that's your home, that's your house?
Yeah, yeah.
And it was, tell me where that structure was.
Right there.
Right there. So you were in there? What happened?
I was in there. My girlfriend was inside and my daughter. When I see the thunder, I just see back at the back and my girlfriend tell me. Tell me. Water. Fancy she say water. Oh, she freeze up. My wife should be in bed. Freeze up. So we tell her, come out, quick. First we put our wall out. Push them inside the wall out.
We're standing in this is your living room area, I assume. Tell us what you experienced on the night of Christmas Eve. Tell us what you experienced.
I was baking and we went inside because I have a young baby, it's about 2+ months. And we heard the rain keep coming. And after the rain keep coming, my niece come and call me and tell me the river bursting. So when we peep outside, we could not grab anything, we just grabbed the child and we just went up in the street. When we went up in the street, the water just keep pouring. And then we just head down the road, running first.
Okay, we're in Spring Village, right? Tell us, when you came back, what condition you met your house in? Because, I mean, it looked totally washed out to me.
There was mud up to here. And we lost everything. These we just wipe them off and bring them in so we can use them first.
What, so you met them outside?
They were in the house, but the mud has covered them. If you notice all the jars here, the mud has reached.
What condition they met your parents, well, your grandparents, your mother, in the house? What was like, what you heard happen in the house? You were telling me about your grandmother's leg being displaced. What?
They found my grandfather downstairs because their room is on this end, on the end facing to the road. So they found him downstairs. And I think he has a dent in his forehead. And his two legs are amputated. This is what I was told. They found my grandmother. Her leg recently got broken and I think it displaced again and her hip is out of place. One of my cousins, he was already out of the house and he went back for his phone to call, that he need to call for help. And he never made it back. They found his brother, which is my other cousin. He's disabled. He was disabled. Couldn't walk, couldn't talk. And I'm assuming that they all found them, the bodies, in one place. And I'm assuming that they were trying to help my disabled cousin and my grandfather. We were trying to get them out. But my mother was not entirely gone as yet because my brother was holding on to her hand while she was buried under. So he could hear his voice and he said the last thing he told her was live life and take care of yourself.
That is such a sad story, so much devastation. Our condolences to all those who lost loved ones in that disaster. We continue where earlier today, Prime Minister Dr. Rav Gonsalves led a delegation of officials to the Leeward Coast to assess firsthand the devastation there. Here is more on that visit.
One of the major jobs this is inspired really, river defenses. Let me bring you up to date as to where we are. I have a meeting tomorrow at 10 o'clock, which I schedule with contractors, local and regional. My office is also called in the banks, credit unions. The government of Trinidad and Tobago sent a representative. I've asked them so to the government of Barbados, the Caribbean Development Bank, European Union may send someone. They're a little short staffed at the moment because, you know, it's a Christmas period. My staff is in touch with the World Bank. We are through the European Union making contact with the humanitarian office of the European Union. Where certain emergency resources can come from. So we're we're trying to line up all the ducks, so to speak, as we move forward. I want them to get a close and upfront idea as to what we're doing, what is the extent of the challenge before us. I spoke to Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, Prime Minister of Barbados, the President of the CDP, spoke to the European Union Ambassador based in Barbados, I spoke to Prime Ministers Douglas and Spencer may be here tomorrow, the Governor of the Central Bank, made certain requests of him. So we're trying to line up everything as best we can.
So we're here with Acting Commissioner of Police, Michael Charles. We know that 5 persons are still unaccounted for. The Coast Guard is continuing its search. Tell us, you know, exactly what it is.
Yes, the Coast Guard is still making it the checks around the west of the Bukoma area, and confirmed this morning members of the Special Services Unit, the RLU, and from this Western Division are in the Bukoma Peniston area, still making checks. As I stated earlier, we not expected to find a living person right now, but we just want to make the family happy if we can just recover anybody if it's there.
Here with the director of the National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO. Mr. Prince, I have a few questions. I want you to first tell us really the role of NEMO. Is NEMO's responsibility to inform, warn us of a disaster, or to respond after disaster has occurred?
It's a dual role in that respect. If we have information of an impending situation, of weather situation that can produce certain kinds of damage, we will give that to the people as advance or early warning. I think the question that most people are trying to ask is, how come nobody heard of this information?
That was actually my second question.
because it's the kind of system that has affected us. The system is one that is called a low-level trough system. In the case of troughs, they are elongated clouds. Elongated means a long sheet of cloud that drift from place to place. There is no indication whatsoever in terms of where they're likely to drift.
I might be asking you a question a little bit out of your realm, but persons have been saying that, well, I witnessed this part, the constant flashing, the very unusual type of lightning. How would you explain that?
I really don't have an explanation for the lightning. It really was quite unusual, and that is because of the intensity of the energy that is up there in the sky. It's kind of like a microcell, a very concentrated cell of thunderstorms, and it can produce almost continuous lightning like that. Mm-hmm. Some of it very, 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 very bright, very, very damaging in some cases. We were happy that nobody got killed by lightning strikes.
They heard stuff falling on their house roofs. I mean, I think that was, I don't know. Tell you have any comments on that?
I was not in a position where I could tell I saw hail. There are people who say that the sound that the rain made on their roof,
so grainy tones.
What felt more like if people were throwing fine stones on the house, as opposed to the normal raindrops. Whether there was hail is something that we can't prove, because to prove hail, you have to show hail. You have to pick up one of the pieces.
And over the last few days, the devastation caused by the trough system has left its mark on the minds and in the hearts of all Vincentians. Let's take a closer look at the damage experienced on the leeward side of the country.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason. And it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Oh, beautiful release.
windward side of the island, damage to infrastructure, including houses, bridges, and roads, were insurmountable, taking the life of one person. Rosha Batiste has the story from that side of the island in this report.
Mannings is a fairly new village in the Baira area. Some of the residents living there were relocated a few years ago. Like most Vincentians, the residents of the small community were preparing to enjoy the Christmas with family and friends when disaster struck, taking the life of Raymond Gonsalves, better known as Cassius. Neighbor Cecilia Gurley Durand recounted what happened on the fatal Christmas Eve night as she sat on her porch with friends.
I said, oh God, something come down up there. They tell me, no, is the river stone them? I said, no, something come down. So when I run out, I heard somebody screaming. It was Mr. Gonsalves' wife. She said, oh God, girl in Cassian dead in the room. So I thought was he had problem with his heart, eh? So I thought was he taking with his heart and die. So I run up the same time. When I run up, I asked, I said, what happened? When I break inside the house, what I behold, I couldn't believe it.
Thanking God for sparing her life, Durand described the death of the man who she called a good friend, a sad situation.
For ever since, me and his real friend, when I say friend is friend, we get along real good as neighbor, share everything, and he is a nice person. Anything, he just come out and tell you, he's mine. And when he done, he finish with that. So I could say, give God thanks and praise, because if it wasn't his house, it could not be me. So I'm so glad I'm alive today.
One of the lucky residents of Manning's village who escaped the wrath of the trough system is 72-year-old Ariel Grant. Showing the scars on her knees from her daring escape through a window, Grant is thanking God and her granddaughter for saving her life.
And I have to walk on my knee. My 2 foot is stinking in the mud, and then she's really struggling with me. And then after I see that she cannot make it with me, I walk on my hand and my 2 knees. And then we go by the neighbor, and God is so good that when I reach to my neighbor, I hear Basha again. Both of us would have died. And I want to give God a high note of praise for sparing me and my granddaughter life. I thank God for his goodness, his grace, and his mercy.
Although she lost most of her household possessions, Grant, who is now staying with one of her daughters in another part of Baira, says she is not worried about the material things at this time.
But I have to say that is minor thing. While I have life, I have hopes. And I trust God for his goodness and his grace to me with me and my granddaughter, is sparing my life. Because if my granddaughter wasn't there, I would have been a dead person.
Further up north in Georgetown, this is what left of the Carrital Bridge. This is the second bridge in the Georgetown area to be destroyed by a natural disaster. The Lanley Park Bridge is still undergoing construction after it was battered by Hurricane Thomas and again by the Christmas Eve trough system. In Valley, in the Dixon area, the residents there were also not spared. They too were severely affected by Hurricane Thomas. Now again, they are cleaning up the pieces of what's left of their property. In Sandy Bay, Point Village, Owia, and Fancy, these areas were completely cut off from vehicular traffic as there were numerous major landslides which covered the main roadways. Earlier today, front-end loaders and persons were seen clearing some of the debris. Back down to the South Rivers area, the main river overflowed its banks. When we visited the area earlier today, many residents were seen in the said river washing, cleaning up their household items. As one resident puts it, this was not a Merry Christmas for many Vincentians. It was a sad one that will be remembered for a long time to come. Rochelle Batiste for SVGTV News.
Area representative for South Windward, Frederick Stevenson, was one of the many persons on the streets in the Georgetown area on Christmas Day assessing the damage. He described the situation as a lot of devastation and called on Vincentians to put their hands together to help rebuild the country.
Let us think of what Jesus said. He came on earth to bring peace, and let us live in peace, in unity and concord as we seek to rebuild this beautiful nation state of ours. It would take some time, But I know with God's help and friends from overseas and our own locals.
We'll take a break now, and when we come back, we'll tell you about damage to some equipment at the Milton Keynes Memorial Hospital. More stories on the local scene when SVGTV News continues. Stay with us. Welcome back. 8 critical departments at the Milton Keynes Memorial Hospital had to be abandoned after floodwaters rushed through the premises on Christmas Eve night. Chief Medical Officer Simone Kieser told SVGTV News that patients had to be evacuated to higher ground and makeshift wards established. We get more in this report.
Patients on the ground floor of the Milton Keynes Memorial Hospital had to be relocated in the wee hours of Christmas morning as gushing waters intruded the medical institution. Among the wards affected were the pediatric ward, the male surgical ward, the physiotherapy department, and the maternity aid ward, as well as the accounts and record department, central sterilizing department, maintenance, and bulk storage areas. Chief Medical Officer Simone Kieser said the nurses moved quickly to evacuate the patients to higher ground. She added that as a result of the flooding, a lot of items were destroyed, including patients and accounting records and other documents. Kieser added that many of their basic cleaning items were also destroyed by the flood waters. She added that the drain which passes under the hospital overflowed and as a result flooded the institution. She explained that the water in some departments was waist deep. At present, the patients have not yet been relocated to the ground floor as cleaning continues. Outlining her concern for the nation's health, the chief medical officer said persons must be aware of the water they use as they are no longer dealing with the everyday muddy water. She advises persons to visit their district clinics for the water purification tablets and to ensure that all water stored be boiled before use. For SVGTV News, I am Zuleika Lewis.
Prime Minister Dr. Rav Gonsalves says he is deeply pained by the loss of lives here on Christmas Eve. Speaking on radio last evening, Dr. Gonsalves says he feels the loss in a very personal way and will do his very best to help everyone.
We have to be united. We have to help one another. And we have to be heroic, each of us, in the performance of our duties and carrying out our responsibilities. I want the persons who have suffered, lost in their families, I want to say to them again that I feel your loss.
Dr. Gonsalves urged Vincentians to lift themselves and work together to rise again.
Let us in this very small country stop all the senseless backbiting and fighting over nothing. Let us get rid of all our vanities as far as it's humanly possible. Let us show greater neighborly love. Let us show caring. Let us look out for one another. As Prime Minister, I promise you to do even better than I've tried always to do. Let us work together. We will recover. We will rehabilitate this country, and we will do so in the shortest possible time.
Meantime, Prime Minister Gonsalves has asked Vincentians to remember other countries which have suffered as well during the Christmas season.
Let us remember the people of Dominica and St. Lucia, our brothers and sisters in Brazil and Mexico, those who have suffered in England, in Canada. Let us, we are part of humanity, and we are joined together by a common weather system, which would have a manifestation in different ways, in different forms, different times, in different places.
And Central Leeward Representative Maxwell Charles has described Christmas 2013 in SVG as a very sad one. In an interview with SVG-TV News, Charles says it is very sad to see that so many homes and lives perished for the season. He noted that in all his life he has never experienced a Christmas of this kind.
I could remember last night I was in Byerly. Then when I came up from Byerly, I was at my brother there with cousins, and we were spreading some Christmas joy. The rain continued, and then we saw the volume of water, and we realized that it was not rainwater. It was the actual river coming to destroy properties, and that was scary. I nearly slept away from home last night, although it was just within 200 yards of home. So I had to wait until, you know, the water subsided, and then I walked, I waded through the water and got home. And there I met some neighbors who slept by me last night. You know, well, we didn't sleep really, we sat down and we dozed and nodded and so on. A very sad Christmas.
Charles extended condolences to the families who lost loved ones during the disaster.
Many sad stories, and we just pray that as the time goes by, that healing would come to the souls of many as a result of this tragedy. Let's come together, let's work together with each other and for each other, so that we can get out of this unfortunate situation. But I have the confidence that as Vincentians, we will rise again.
Meanwhile, President of the New Democratic Party, Anim Eustace, said he was moved to tears as he toured the devastated Cane Grove, Buckamount and Vermont communities yesterday. Speaking on Nice Radio after spending some 6 hours in Central and South Leeward, Eustace said the human suffering and anguish he witnessed as persons were busy clearing debris and consoling each other were remarkable. The opposition leader extended personal condolences to those persons who lost loved ones and suffered damage. Eustace was joined on his tour by area representative for South Leeward, Nigel Stevenson, candidate for the NDP in Central Leeward, Ben Exeter, MP for West Kingstown, Daniel Cummings, and Senator Vinette Frederick. Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, Kamala Prasad Bisesser, has pledged her country's assistance to SVG following the trough system which affected the island over the Christmas season. Keeping true to her word, an aircraft with disaster officials arrived here earlier today to help assess the damage done island-wide. We get more in this report.
Emergency supplies are expected to land here from neighboring island Trinidad and Tobago, complements their Prime Minister Kamala Prasad Bisesser. A delegation of three Vincentians, including Minister of Transport and Works Julian Francis, Chief Engineer Brent Bailey, and Chief Nursing Officer Peggy De Silva, will accompany this helicopter behind me up to the windward side and the leeward side, where they will fly over and have a tour from the top.
Acting under command of his Prime Minister, Admiral Richard Cashel led the first regional delegation to this country as assistance begins to pour in the wake of the devastating trough system over the Christmas season. Admiral Cashel and his counterpart, Chief Executive Officer of the National Disaster Preparedness Organization, Stephen Ramrup, arrived here to tour and assess the extent of damage done to the island. The Trinidadian delegation met with other local officials in the VIP lounge of the E.C. Joshua Airport. There they discussed plans of touring the island to get a clearer picture of what occurred over the last couple of days. The Admiral, who is the Regional Security Coordinator in the office of the TNT Prime Minister, said they can assist with getting water to those in need throughout the island.
With respect to the water that you won't deliver, that could be the easiest one first. The other stuff such as food and mattresses and whatnot may take a little longer. It's for us to come, see, hear what you need, rather than bring a whole load of stuff you don't need. Now, what we want to do is to find out what your priorities are, so we can get back there and shift the cargo around so that you get what you need.
According to NEMO's Deputy Director Michelle Forms, the three main resources needed at this time are food, water and bedding. A delegation of seven persons took the sky-high tour of the island this afternoon to access some areas that were still cut off and in need of basic necessities. They were expected to land in Fancy on the windward side of the island, where little or no communication existed over the past 2 days. For SVG TV News, I am Zulika Lewis.
And Vincentians in the diaspora are mobilizing resources to aid those in need here at home. SVG's consulate in New York, in association with COSAGO, will be coordinating a relief drive tomorrow at the Friends of Crown Heights Daycare Center. They are seeking to gather medical supplies, food, clothing, water, and money. The organizations are appealing to Vincentians in New York and other areas in the USA to give their support to their homeland. That's the local news. Coming up, communities all over St. Lucia said to be significantly impacted by trough system. News from the region when we return. Don't go away.